Now I'm videoing it. What the f***?
I think that might be a gas station or something.
The gas. Whoa! Oh! What the f***?
A massive explosion rocked Tianjin, China, on August 12, 2015, shattering apartment windows from miles away, and sending hundreds of container vans skyward. Residents were warned to close their windows in case of hazardous gases. When the dust settled, 165 people were killed, and more than 500 wounded. Munition experts confirm that the blast signature is that of a tactical nuclear bomb. The fact that the fireball was whited out or clipped indicates that the color temperature was over 4,000 degrees Celsius, only achievable in a nuclear blast. The camera's auto-gain circuit, AGC, clips the video level for being too bright, so you get a whiteout on the screen, nuclear explosion expert Jeff Smith said. Over 200 nuclear and biochemical experts, including a team from the International Atomic Energy Agency, began arriving in Tianjin to assess the health risks from the chemicals being released into the atmosphere, a section of the Wikipedia article about the event said. Collaborating evidence also came in the form of toasted cars that looked similarly like those seen on September 11, 2001. Who blasted China on August 12, 2015, and why? The events leading to the Tianjin explosion were of tectonic proportion. Saw stock markets tumbling to their lowest in decades.
On September 15, 2008, Lehman Brothers, the fourth largest investment bank in the world, declared bankruptcy, sparking chaos in the financial markets and nearly bringing down the global economy. It was the largest bankruptcy in history, larger than General Motors, Washington Mutual, Enron, and WorldCom combined.
That was in retaliation for the 1997 Soros-led financial coup against Southeast Asia and China. In the next 2 years, the Western financial cabal would be scrambling for funds, and they'll go beyond taxpayers' money. On the first day of November year 2010, Baron James of Blackheath made a stunning speech about a certain Foundation X that is willing to fund massive public works projects in the UK. With vast currency reserves backed by gold bullion.
British FSA-controlled financial institution, he asked me if I could help him in getting identification of the validity of people who had bought to him a huge transaction for a corporate reconstruction. And could I help him by validating people? Because he knew that I had connections from the past where I could get onto various intelligence agencies and establish the validity of people. And that's how it started.
And what is it that they're offering?
They're representing themselves as a massive supranational accumulation of funds which are not sovereign national foreign funds, but are the proceeds of a massive amount of commercial activity which have accumulated over probably most of 100 years. And they are concerned that they have all this wealth in a world which is beginning to lose its track on its own economic progress and stability, and they want to put their assets to work to help save the world.
So they think that by helping plug the UK debt, they'll boost their own wealth.
They're quite directly saying, no, they're not. They're saying that they will protect the wealth of the world so that they will continue to survive with their wealth in it. But they are saying quite particularly that they want the United Kingdom to take a leading initiative in this, because they see us as being the logical point from which they can deploy a lot of their support into the European sector, which they think is in dire need of help and support at this time.
And you believe that this is a genuine offer and not a hoax?
I've been working on this now with them for 21 weeks. They have not put a foot wrong in 21 weeks. They have never contradicted themselves or said anything which would give a lie to anything that they have said. And therefore, from that point of view, I am progressively comfortable with the genuineness of their approach. They have gone out of their way to ask me to introduce them to government officials within the coalition with whom they can talk to open this up. And there has been a natural high level of scepticism, because it's rather like finding, after all these years, the good gracious, you find on Christmas Eve that Father Christmas really does exist and he's just popped down your chimney, and it is a bit of a surprise.
And if this did go ahead, what would it look like? What would it mean for Britain?
It would mean a massive improvement in the job market, because so much of what they're doing is aimed at creating infrastructure, which is headcount intensive. For example, the things that they're proposing at the present moment, since Monday they have said to me that if the government will now give an answer to them now as to whether they will support this, and by now I think they mean in the course of the next week, then X will put up and have in our bank by Christmas Day the entire £17 billion we need to build Crossrail now and bring it forward from the 10-year distant date it is. And think how many jobs that will create and the impact that will have on the vitality of London and everything else that will go with it. That creates GDP, which is wealth, and that brings money into the equation. But they're also quite specifically saying, look, you can't afford to hang back on your renewable energy policy. So if you have a preferred policy at this moment to do the underground gasification of coal and the conversion of your power stations to use underground gasification coal, we will pay for that as well. But your spending review has also taken out all the hospitals and the schools that you needed to build, and we'll build those for you as well.
And would this money come with strings attached?
It comes interest-free, and it comes with no requirement to guarantee the value when it is paid back, and it comes with no repayment schedule, so it can be with us for as long as we need it. My lords, I'm going to start. I don't wish you to get too encouraged by that. I'm going to start with my conclusions, but I'm not going to...
He made a follow-up when he claimed on the 16th of February 2012, that a massive $15 trillion money laundering fraud from the United States Federal Reserve was perpetrated in the name of one Johannes Riedel.
I've been engaged in this pursuit of this issue for nearly 2 years now, and I'm no further through to getting to the truth. I think there are three possible conclusions which may come from it. I think there may have been a massive piece of money laundering committed by a major government which ought to know better, and that this has effectively undermined the integrity of a British bank, Royal Bank of Scotland, in doing so. The second alternative is that a major American department has an agency which has gone rogue on it because it has been wound up and has created a structure out of which they are seeking to get, well, at least 50 billion euros as a payoff. And the third possibility is that this is an extraordinary elaborate fraud which has not been carried out, but which has been prepared in order to provide a threat to one government or more if they don't pay them off. So there are three possibilities, and this all needs a very urgent review. My lords, it starts in April and May of 2009 with the alleged transfer to the United Kingdom, to the HSBC, of a sum of $50 trillion. And 7 days later, ping, in comes another $50 trillion to the HSBC, and then 3 weeks later, another $50 trillion, total of $5 trillion in each case, total of $15 trillion is alleged to have been passed into the hands of HSBC for onward transit to the Royal Bank of Scotland. And we need to look to where this came from and what the history of this money is. And I have been trying to sort out the sequence by which this money has been created and where it's come from for a long time. It starts off apparently as the property of a man called Johannes Riardi, who has some claims to be considered the richest man in the world. Well, he would be if all the money that was owed to him was paid, but I have seen accounts of his showing he owns $36 trillion in a bank, and it is a ridiculous sum of money. On the other hand, the $36 trillion would be consistent with the dynasty from which he comes and the fact that they had been effectively the emperors of Indochina in times gone by. But a lot of that money has been taken away from him with his consent by the American Treasury over the years for the specific purpose of helping to support the dollar. And he has sent to me a really quite remarkable document, which is dated in February 2006, in which the American government have called him to a meeting with the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, which is neither Federal Reserve nor a bank. It's a bit like Celebrity Big Brother. It's got three names to describe it, and none of them are true. And this document, which is quite astonishing, purports to have been a meeting which is witnessed by Mr. Alan Greenspan, who signed for the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, of which he was chairman, as well as the real Federal Reserve Bank in Washington. And it is signed by Mr. Timothy Geithner, who as a witness on behalf of the International Monetary Fund, who sent two witnesses, the other one being Mr. Yusuke Horiguchi. And these gentlemen have signed as witnesses to the effect that this deal is a proper deal. There are a lot of other signatures on here. This is not a photocopy. This is an original version of the contract, under which the American Treasury have apparently got the Federal Reserve Bank of New York to offer to buy out the bonds which have been issued to Mr. Riardi to replace the cash which has been taken from him over the previous 10 years. And they're giving him half of $500 million as a cash payment to buy out worthless bonds. Now, this is all in the agreement, and it's very remarkable. I would have thought establishing whether this is...
James Blackheath offered to provide evidence and asked for an official investigation. Such documentary evidence can provide an example of the methods by which the ruling cabal finances its criminal enterprise, intending the total domination of planet Earth. These same documents have been submitted to the United States House and Senate, in addition to all law enforcement agencies having the capability to arrest and prosecute these corrupt criminals, according to the White Hats. A week after James Blackheath's brave speech in the House of Lords, we published the Massive Resignations Have Begun article on our website, documenting the unprecedented resignations of the banking CEOs and heads of state worldwide. These high-profile resignations were punctuated a year later with the resignation of Pope Benedict XVI himself, the first papal resignation within the last 600-year history of the Vatican. What this means is that the entire financial system of the West has been hemorrhaging all along, if not for the historical assets of the Asian royalties.
Today, I have this quite piece of paper, which is my justification for bringing it into this meeting today, which is available on the internet, and I'm astonished that it hasn't already been unearthed by the Treasury, and every alarm bell in the land should be ringing if it has, because this is the General Audit Office of the Federal Reserve, the real Federal Reserve in Washington, and its audit review in end of July 2010 on the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. It has on it some 20 banks listed, to which $16.115 trillion are outstanding in loans. My lords, that is the sore thumb that was being looked for by Lord Sassoon. But more particularly, there are two other very interesting things with this. The first is that Barclays Bank have got $868 billion alone. The Royal Bank of Scotland has got $541 billion, in which case one has to ask, as they could have earned in 3 weeks enough to pay off their entire indebtedness to the taxpayers in Britain, why they have not done so, and could we please ask them to put a cheque in the post tonight for the whole $46 billion? And the third thing that's wrong with it is that every bank on this list, without exception, is an MTN registered bank, which means that they are registered to use medium-term notes to move funds between themselves with an agreed profit-share formula, in which case these banks are investing this money, and most extraordinary, not a penny of interest does the Federal Bank of New York want paid on this vast amount of $16 trillion. Anyone amongst yourselves who knows what the IMF rules are will immediately smell a rat. Because the IMF has very strict rules for validating dodgy money. There are two ways of doing it. You either pass it through a major central bank like the Bank of England, who had apparently refused to touch this, or alternatively, you put it through to a bank which is an MTN trading bank, and which is then able to use the funds on the overnight European MTN trading market, where they can earn between 1% and 2.5% profit per night. And the compound interest on that is huge. So there is a vast profit being made with this money somewhere, if it is in fact genuine. So, my lords, I believe that this is such an important issue now that I've put everything I've got on the subject into a 104-megabyte memory thumb, and I want the government to put this to some suitable investigative bureau and take everything I've got on the subject and find out what the truth is of what is going on here, because there is something very seriously wrong. Either we have a huge amount of tax uncollected on profits made, or we have a vast amount of money festering away in the European banking system, which is not real money, in which case we need to take it back. My lords, I ask for an investigation, and please support my plea.
We are here today to announce the filing of criminal charges against HSBC Bank, both its U.S. entity, HSBC U.S., and the parent HSBC Group, for its sustained and systemic failure to guard against the corruption of our financial system by drug traffickers and other criminals, and for evading U.S. sanctions law. HSBC, as you know, is one of the largest financial institutions in the world, with affiliates and personnel spanning the globe. Yet during the relevant time periods, they failed to comply with the legal requirements incumbent on all U.S. financial institutions to have in place compliance mechanisms and safeguards to guard against being used for money laundering.
If the cabal behind the daylight robbery against Johannes Riady was successful in perpetrating its crime, the same cannot put China in line with their plans to dominate the world. But China prefers to use its soft power to promote goodwill, and struck a win-win cooperation with everyone who are willing to do so.
Honorable Majesties, Ministers, I'm very proud to have Nepal as the founding member, one of the 57 founding members of Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. I am very much committed to be working with your government, your people, and the private sector to make a meaningful difference in the economic and social development in your country through our investment in infrastructure and other productive sectors.
With China's help, Ethiopia achieved its first 11% economic growth, and Pakistan is undergoing an infrastructure construction boom.
Authority building. Gwadar in Balochistan will now rank as one of the most strategic ports in the region, with Jabal Ali and Bandar Abbas.
Gwadar,
Gwadar too will become the gateway of prosperity for the province of Balochistan and Pakistan as a whole. Gwadar Port has a very important strategic position where investments have been poured in by China, and soon industrialization will kick off, which will not only create jobs for thousands of people, but will also change the whole country.
Gwadar cuts distances by thousands of kilometers, reducing travel time and opening up a new trade corridor.
China has also offered the same path to the UK government by proposing to fund the installation of nuclear plants in the island, and invited them to join the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, with only one condition, that is end all wars of aggression. The Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank is just one of the three development banks that will finance the infrastructure needs of the entire Eurasian continent and its peripheral countries, which will join the One Belt, One Road economic program.
IB has taken new applications. Unsurprisingly, Hong Kong is in, as are Afghanistan, Armenia, Fiji, and Timor-Leste. Canada is now the first North American country to get on board. In Europe, it's Belgium, Hungary, and Ireland. In South America, Peru and Venezuela are joining. There are also two new African members, Sudan and Ethiopia.
The number of countries that are openly joining this massive new Silk Road economic program is proof enough the nations on Earth prefer to cooperate with one another rather than dominate the rest in a zero-sum game.
This is a growth region, it's an exciting region, and so some of those countries, they want to be part of the development discussion.
Their role in helping to develop our Nigerian infrastructure is being absolutely great. The Chinese government has come to support the efforts of those banks to promote development infrastructure. And investment in that sector in Nigeria alone is running into billions of dollars.
Although business activity is limited for now, everyone here is optimistic about the prospects.
With the development of this port city, not only will our businesses prosper, but also local and foreign investors will come here for better business opportunities.
Beyond the calculated use of soft power is the expansion of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, which provides the platform for non-BRICS countries to cooperate with China, not just in economic terms, but also in areas of mutual security, which led to another game-changing development in the region.
Your Honors, in this venue, I announce my separation from the United States.
After the Philippine president expressed his intention to join the Eastern Alliance, the once sleeping giant China is now arming the country against global terrorism. Global terror is the Eastern Alliance's euphemism for the deep state CIA.
They fire mortars toward the enemy's direction and shoot at them from afar.
It is also protecting the entire South China Sea from any unilateral aggression, and is providing a strong deterrence, together with Russia, against outsiders' control of one of the most critical sea lanes in the region.
These pictures taken from the American P-8 sub Hunter show just how close the Chinese fighter jet came. Close enough for the American crew to easily see details on the Chinese craft, and even the pilot inside.
It's difficult to say with precision, but within 30 feet of the P-8. Very, very close. Very dangerous.
And it didn't happen just once. As the American plane flew on what is being called a routine patrol mission, repeatedly the Chinese fighter roared over, under, and beside it.
The Chinese jet also passed the nose of the P-8 at 90 degrees with its belly toward the P-8 Poseidon. We believe to make a point of showing its weapons loadout.
Military officials say the incident occurred in international airspace about 135 miles east of Hainan Island, just off the south coast of China. And it is just the latest sign of friction as America and its allies clash with the Russians and Chinese over surveillance in the region. Earlier this year, the U.S. moved two of its largest drones to Japan. They're called Global Hawks and are used for surveillance. And last April, north of Japan, a Russian jet buzzed another U.S. plane designed to track radar signals. The Russian pilot came within 100 feet that time and again flashed his weapons at the American plane. So U.S. officials clearly see a pattern of pushbacks continuing with this more recent encounter.
After some dizzying diplomatic exchanges in the last few months, a deal has been reached by China and the Philippines for the joint exploration of the natural resources of the disputed areas in the South China Sea.
The Philippines and other 在中非和东盟各国的共同努力之下， 南海局势已经明显趋稳，合作理念在上升，经济利益因素在增长，中非关系的转换对此发挥了关键的作用。当前，DOC落实已经取得重要的成果，COC的框架也已经形成。至于事实，向世人表明，中国和东盟各国完全有能力、有智慧处理好彼此的分歧，维护好南海的稳定。如果仍然有一些
Other claimants to the sporadic group of islands are also invited to participate. The ASEAN members, and China, have all stopped listening to the diktats of foreign geopolitical manipulators and purveyors of world terror. It is for this reason that the new CIA chief has lamented that China is far more dangerous than Russia. The Western oligarchs and imperialists have yet to come to terms with the reality that they are not in control of world affairs anymore.
No!
The centuries of lies and deceptions have been exposed as they are. Indeed, humanity is on the cusp of being set free from the scourge of terror and fear. But we must realize that real freedom can only be acquired through willful action, and it starts by knowing how the great con game is being played.
On many people's lives in one way or another.
What you're just seeing is a cartel in operation, which not maybe did exist and did distort LIBOR for the benefit of the largest banks in the cartel. It is the largest rigging of prices in the history of the world by many orders of magnitude.
The Lehman Crash 2008 was engineered by the Deep State, Federal Reserve Board, to send global stock prices to their lowest, so that they could buy them with the trillions of dollar money they have created from the 750 metric ton Riyadi gold, bearing in mind that this is on top of the $15 trillion, nay $29 trillion taxpayers' bailout of the too big to fail banks. The whole thing illustrates the Western deep state's willingness to sacrifice the welfare of the Western population, even within the capitalist system that they themselves created. Beyond fighting the information war, we must join all efforts to remove the parasites from the system itself.
Three men, aged 33, 41, and 47, have been arrested as part of the ongoing investigation into the LIBOR rigging scandal. Search warrants were issued for three properties in the southeast of England, one in Surrey and two in Essex. The three men, all confirmed to be British nationals, have been transported.
Whatever new system we wish to establish in the future, the people-to-people cooperation for mutual progress is the only way to move this beautiful planet forward. We will discuss more aspects of the ongoing covert hybrid World War III on the next episode of this documentary. Don't forget to like, share and drop us a comment. This has been a production of the Covert Geopolitics at www.geopolitics.co. If you can see the significance of what we do, you can support us through www.patreon.com/geopolitics. Thank you for watching.